everyone, I'm Kelly, Office Manager here at Grace Church. We have a few announcements for you this week. Bruce Harvest is in need of canned vegetables. If you have any, feel free to drop them off in the lobby. Next Saturday, February 20th, is our blood drive. We are in need of volunteers. If you are able to help, please contact the church office or Belinda Maxwell. Next Wednesday, we will be having our Ash Wednesday service. We will be live streaming and in person. Pastor Todd will be offering the church to receive ashes outside of the Ash Wednesday service from 9 a.m. until 12 p.m. on the morning of the 17th. Ashes will be given with social distancing safeties. Finally, the story of reality will be a Bible study held by Brian Jenkins beginning March 1st. If you're interested, please contact the church office or Brian Jenkins directly. Thanks and have a great day.
Well, good morning, church. I want to welcome everyone. If you're tuning in online, welcome as well.
At our church, Jesus is Lord. That single belief calls us together as a community and sends us into our world with hope and purpose. At our church, your past will never define your future. There's always redemption, which means there's always a brighter day. At our church, we don't think we're better than any other church out there. We're just doing our best to become our best. At our church, we want you to believe in God, but we also want you to know that God believes in you. We are not against people who don't attend church anywhere. Instead, we pursue them with love, the very same love that's pursuing us. At our church, we're learning to serve God with all our hearts, and we're learning to worship Him with all our lives. And if you're looking for the perfect church, we're not it. At our church, we will make mistakes, but we will choose to grow from them. At our church, we're part of a global community that's knit together by the resurrection of Jesus. And by the way, at our church, we believe that really happened too. At our church, we will engage with people who are in real need because we are the hands and the feet of Christ. And finally, we need you to hear this loud and clear. At our church, it's not really our church at all, it's His. And we live and move and breathe in His church for His glory and His fame, not ours. So here's the invitation. You're invited to jump in with your whole heart at your own pace and to experience the life that awaits you in Christ. Friends, this is going to be good. Welcome to our church.
Good morning again. I want to welcome everybody to Grace United Methodist Church. If it's your first time here, we're happy to have you. If you're tuning in at home, welcome as well. We have just maybe one or two additional announcements. Kelly took care of the announcements earlier. We do have the Three Hogs fundraiser going on right now, and there are order forms available for the barbecue food at the greeting station. That's a fundraiser to help replace a lot of the aging equipment we have here at the church. Does anybody have any other announcements? Okay. If not, then please join us in singing "Come Now Is the Time to Worship." The song comes from Romans 14:11. "For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me and every tongue shall confess." Please stand and join us in singing.
Is the time to worship? Come, just is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are. For your God, come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose. come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are, to worship. Come, just as you are before.
Our next song is from the Believe series, which is the series we started a few weeks ago. It's God of Forever. The Bible talks to us about how eternal our God is. In Isaiah 40:28, have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. Furthermore, in Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever.
You are the very first, you are the last, the God of the days ahead, God of the past, before beginning. You hold eternity in the palm of your hand. God of forever, you are forever. Your love forever is what you made us for. God of forever, you are forever. And you have saved us to be forever yours. Start. You placed eternity in every heart. To you, a thousand years is just a day. But you stepped into time to take our sin away. God of forever, you are forever. Your love forever is what you.
As we come before a time of prayer, please join us in singing Give Thanks.
Gracious God, we give you thanks and praise this day. And God, as you are here with us this morning, as our eyes, our hearts, our minds, and our ears are attentive to you, pour out over us this day. Well up within us to overflowing. God, you are creator. You are redeemer, restorer. You are the uplifter. It's you, God, that has given us life and life eternal. It's you, God, that have given yourself to us in Jesus Christ, the crucified God, whose blood has paid for our sins, who has covered us, whose blood has bridged the gap who's given us everything, everything that you have offered. We praise you, God, through the Holy Spirit. Lord, your presence at work within the world, your presence that nurtures our hearts and speaks to our conscience, that makes pathways, that makes us see your activity all around us. God, each of us this morning comes here. We come here with burdens. We come here with cares and concerns that weigh us down. God, concerns for our loved ones who are hurting, who are broken, who are suffering from disease in need of a healing touch. For our neighbors who are recovering from falls, for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones in this time. For our community that's separated and isolated from one another. God, it's a difficult time indeed. And God, we ask that you pour out your Spirit, you pour out your grace into each and every one of these lives. That you, God, would work within them. And Lord, that you would fill the void. You would free our hands from carrying these burdens that we may lift them in praise. To be comforted. To be made strong. To be made whole. And help us, God, seek to live in our lives the healing that we've witnessed, the strength that we have witnessed, the pathways that we have witnessed. Help us, God, to be those things to others in the world that they may see you as you are working in us and through us. God, it's so easy for us to be focused on the negative. It's so easy for us to be focused on the hard. But God, we know that you are making diamonds. And it's in the hard. It's in the struggle. It's in the darkness that our faith is refined. That the struggle produces fruit. And we thank you, God, that we are never in the struggle alone. We thank you, God, that you have lifted us and you are beside us to walk us through the struggles. Help us, God, to know that your presence never leaves us. Lord, that we may turn away for a time, but you have never left. Lord, you are our rock. You are our Redeemer. Help us, God, to be affixed on you and work in the lives of those around us and work in our lives, not for our glory, not for our satisfaction, not for our peace, but for you. Glorify your name in each of us and in those around us, that no one could deny, that every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. We pray these things. Amen. Please be seated. As we take a moment to recognize the offering portion of our service, I again come to you and remind you that you are such a treasured gift to our church, to our ministry, that your gifts are changing lives, that your gifts are feeding the hungry, that your gifts are clothing the naked, they're comforting the afflicted, and that we're doing great work as a church. And it's only through your generosity that we can continue to do so. So thank you for your continued faithfulness. God calls us to be a people who gives. God calls us to be a people that gives out of the generosity of our hearts recognizing the grace that we've received. God calls us to give because we are disciples. And to give is a testimony to what God is doing in our lives. God calls us to give. And as you pray about the gift that you're going to give this morning, it's my hope and my prayer that you give with the prompting of God. What's God asking you to give in support of our ministries? You can give in a couple of different ways. First, you can give by bringing your offering in here to the building like you did this morning and put it in the box in the offering box in the hallway before you enter the sanctuary. You can mail your offerings in to Kelly at the office. You can give through the Subsplash Giving app. That's part of our app underneath Give. All of our accounts are available to you. You just go in, you punch the amount you want to give, go to the next, hit the next step down where the down arrow is, and it reveals all three of our accounts and also our fundraiser account as well. And you can give safely and securely there. You can set up to have a reoccurring gift. You can have your gift taken out as often as you want or as little as you want, and you can customize that gift. So as you're taking a moment to give this morning, I invite you to join me as we sing our doxology. Maybe you know it. Okay, do we know it? Okay, I'm throwing Dwayne a curveball because he wasn't expecting this. So, you know what? We're not going to sing the doxology. We're just going to hang it out for a second because I have an idea. I got another idea. Let's pray. God, thank you. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your generosity. And bless the gifts that we are giving right now. Help us, God, to give with joy and gladness in our hearts. Help us, God, to give as you call us to give. Help us, God, to be a testimony to what giving is. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Sometimes I can forget which service I'm at. You guys ever get that way? Sorry, Dwayne. You know, having three services, you'd think I'd be able to keep them straight. So, but anyway, here we go. Our gospel reading this morning comes from John's gospel. John's gospel, chapter 1, verses 9 to 13. Kayla, I'm going to move your music stand if you don't mind. I'm just going to put it right here. John's gospel, chapter 1, verses 9 to 13. The true light that shines on all people was coming into the world. The light was in the world, and the world came into being through the light. But the world didn't recognize the light. The light came to his own people, and his own people did not welcome him. But those who did welcome him, those who believed in his name, he authorized to become God's children. Born not from blood, nor from human desire or passions, but born from God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. So this morning, as we're looking at the Believe series, as we're looking at what it means when we say, I am a Christian, looking at what it means to say, I believe in Jesus. We're getting down to the basic fundamental principles of what that is. What does the Bible say? What does the Bible say about these things? And this morning we're talking about the identity in Christ. What is a Christian identity in Christ? And as I was putting the service together, the messages together this week, I couldn't help but think of the little name tags that you get when you go into a conference or a new small group thing or even a lot of church activities. You have that weird little sticker that goes on your chest that says, hello, my name is, and you put your name down there. That way no one has to ask that awkward question of, hey, and what's your name, right? And what's your name? Hello, my name is. That sticker alone gets us uncomfortable, doesn't it? It gets us a little uncomfortable because it already means that we're in a place that we don't know a whole lot of people, and a whole lot of people don't know us. Am I right? For those of you who are watching online, you put a little high five up there in the chat. Do you know what I'm talking about? We've probably all had some awkward moments at those types of gatherings that usually give us some good reason to have hesitation, right? But to say, hello, my name is to understand that here's how I introduce myself. Here is how I identify my definition of me. I identify my definition of me. It's how we define ourselves. Now, when I was doing my undergraduate work, I took a social science course in which I had to write an ethnographic research paper. Now, that sounds as boring as it sounds, right? But it was a study of subcultures, studying subcultures and studying what brings people together. What brings people together? And what I found was very interesting, that a lot of people come together because they share the same labels. 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 Labels that the world has given them, that society has placed upon them, and labels that they have given themselves. Now, we all have labels, don't we? We all have these things that we carry around with us. Our label could be mother, daughter, friend, coworker, professional, father, son, brother, pastor, mechanic, carpenter, accountant, contractor, doctor. What is it that we place our labels? And so when I would go up to someone, they'd say, and I'd say, well, hello, tell me who you are. Tell me who you are. And that person would begin going down that list of labels. Well, I'm an American. I am a person who's I'm a farmer, I'm married, I have a couple of kids, I've worked in this industry for 20 years, I received this accolade or that accolade or these specific certificates, I've had all these different things, and this is who I am. Now, the problem with that is very simple. Very, very simple. When you begin to define yourself from your external relationships and accomplishments, all you did was tell me who knows you and what you've done. You've given me your resume. You've given me your resume. You have not talked to me about your identity. Identity. Identity are the things that we use to define who we are. And what we place into that identity matters. I think about the 1985 film, The Breakfast Club. Anybody remember it? All right. It's this group of kids, that's high school kids that are in detention on a Saturday morning, back when they used to have Saturday morning detentions. Anybody else besides me get those? No, I never had a Saturday morning detention. I got to be honest. I never had one of those. But they were around whenever I was in school. And they're in detention, and the teacher comes in, or the principal comes in, and he identifies each of them by their labels, not by who they are. Remember, you had the brain, the athlete, the basket case, the princess, and the criminal, right? Right? He defines each of them by their labels, and he attaches, ready for this, he attaches their worth to their labels. And don't we do that as a society? We attach our worth to our labels. So as we get older and life begins to move forward and life doesn't work out the way we thought it would, we begin to take labels and we begin to identify ourselves by our failures. We identify ourselves by our failures. That means Think of it this way. If your marriage fell apart, well, you are now divorced. Maybe you're addicted. Maybe you find yourself in a place where you're jobless, you're unemployed. Maybe you're an outcast, an outsider. Maybe you're a person who feels worthless, isolated. Maybe you're depressed or have anxiety. Maybe you're a person who is not welcome. What are the labels that we've placed in our lives over the years? What are the labels that we've placed in our lives over the years that we have allowed to define our value? If labels describe our value, how valuable do you hold yourself? How valuable do you hold yourself? You may be saying, well, Pastor Todd, this is not the light and fluffy messages that you usually get into. Where's the jokes? Where's the humor? Where's the fun? But this message is really important, especially in today's world. Because there's a world out there that tells you where you failed, that loves to tell you where you failed. You don't believe me? You don't believe me? Turn on your television for 5 minutes. And there is a world out there ready to point their finger and say, this is where you fell short. Maybe you didn't make a team or a group when you were in high school. Maybe you didn't accomplish what you set out to accomplish in this life. Maybe that your life looks like a shambles. It looks like a cyclone struck it. Maybe your life is pretty and perfect on the outside, but hollow and dead on the inside. Because we have allowed outside forces to determine our worth, to determine our value. And that has disastrous effects. I think about newly retired people. Suicide rates are the highest among newly retired folks. Did you know that? Newly retired folks. Because they have spent 20, 30, 40, 50 years in a profession in midst of different relationships. And they have made that their entire identity. And when they transition to retirement and they leave all of those things behind, they are left with a great chasm of emptiness. Because they don't know who they are without those labels. They don't know who they are without those labels. For those who are in the midst of putting labels on themselves that are negative like that, the result is just as disastrous for our young people, for our middle-aged people. I mean, think about how many of you guys have heard about someone going through a midlife crisis, right? They come home at age 42 and they've bought a sports car, right? Or they bought a boat, or they've made some huge drastic change in their life because they looked at their life and realized that they are not where they thought they would be, and they have not, and they don't see the value that they'd hoped for. It's a hard thing. Because we have allowed ourselves as a society to allow others to define who we are. And we have defined ourselves through our failures. Think of it this way. You could do 150 things right at work. And if the boss person comes in and says, hey, you did this wrong, how do you view your entire other work? No, when you do a performance, and someone comes up to you and you have 150 people come up to you and say, you did a fantastic job, dude. That was amazing. And one person comes up to you and says, dude, man, that sucked. What do you take home with you? Okay. For the sake of my sermon, Noah's great at giving me a curveball. That's cool, though, because I give him a lot of curveballs. So, but generally, we only remember the negative. We only remember the negative, and we allow that to define our experience. We have placed a value in the wrong place. Now, this is cool, folks. This is really cool here. Think of it this way. We allow ourselves to be shaped and defined by the value of the aspects that have no authority to give value. Do you hear that? We allow ourselves to be shaped and defined by things that have no authority to define us. I don't let a colleague or a coworker define who I am because they don't have the authority to define who I am. I don't allow me to define who I am because I don't have the authority to define who I am. The only one who can define your worth, define your value, define your identity is the one who created you, the one who made you. And I'll tell you this, Scripture tells us all that we need to know. First is, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. You are made in the image of God. You are made with intentionality. You are made by design. You are not a chance. You are not an accident. You are not something that wasn't supposed to be. You are God's design. God has made you. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. That means, other translation, that you're amazing. You're amazing. You may forget your keys or why you walked into the room 5 seconds ago and you can't find the thing that you were looking for because you put it in a safe space, but guess what? You're amazing. You may find yourself struggling to get in and out of the car or up and down steps, and you may find yourself unable to do the things you once did, but guess what? You're amazing. You may not have your life together. You may have relationship issues. You may not be where you thought you'd be in life. You may not be making that six-figure salary. You're still at a cashier at the convenience store, but guess what? You're amazing. You may be a single mom who is struggling to make it through working two jobs, who has a patchwork quilt of childcare, and you're wondering what you did in life. You're looking at it, all your failures. Guess what? You're amazing. You are amazing. Because God designed you. You're amazing. If you didn't get into the school clubs that you wanted to get into, then you didn't hang out with the same people you want to hang out to. If you're not in the in crowd, guess what? You're amazing because God has fearfully and wonderfully made you. You are amazing. You are valued. That is who you are. God has spoken over you, and you are fearfully and wonderfully made. You, John's gospel tells us that we are the children of God. 1 John tells us that God has lavished his love on us. To live lavishly is to just live with excess. God has excessively loved you. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. God has excessively loved you. You are worth. You have value. You are sacred, treasured, and loved. That is who you are. And you understand, if you don't understand why that's important, it's because knowing who you are is what gets you through the hardest times of your life. Knowing who you are is what gets you through the hardest times of your life. And if you are holding on to relationships to define you or achievements to define you, guess what? God tells us that all these things will pass away. All these things are temporary. As relationships end, as a temporal world gives way, and life takes more than it gives, if you allow those things to define you, you are holding on to a straw man. But if you know that the one who has the authority of the universe has called you by name, who meticulously puts you together in your mother's womb, who has told you that you were worth everything, then I believe we'll see a significant drop in depression, anxiety, addiction, unhealthy relationships. I think about today, especially, this is Valentine's Day, right? And there's either one of the most romantic years or one of the most feared days of our society. For those who are find themselves in the middle 40s and are like, where's my love? Where's the relationship? And they find themselves, they're throwing themselves at unhealthy things that will bring hurt and brokenness into their lives because they think that they have to, in order for them to have value, there needs to be a person there to do so. And they've allowed themselves to believe that lie, and our culture has pushed us to believe that lie. But you have worth and value now. Because God has given everything for you. God in Christ has purchased us at a great price. God could not allow people to exist in darkness. God needed to bring them the light because we are God's most sacred possession. Did you hear that? You are God's most sacred possession. God has given everything for you. John 5:24 tells us, very truly I tell you, whoever hears my words and believes him who has sent me has eternal life and will not be judged. God says, I have given you Christ so that you won't have condemnation, but that you'll have life. You're not going to be held guilty because God has paid the penalty. There's no conviction. You have defined value. You have an identity that gives you intrinsic worth. Intrinsic worth. You have a purpose far more important than you can ever imagine. And here's what I want you to do with this. Here's what I want you to do with this. Is think of all the labels that you've placed on yourself. Think of all the labels that you've accepted from others. And I want you to say, get away from me. Let them go. Brush them off. And stand up. And stand strong. And say, hello, my name is a child of God. Say that with me. Hello, my name is a child of God. Say that again. Hello, my name is a child of God. Hello, my name is a child of God. You are a child of the God Most High. You have value. You have worth. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter what past decisions you've made. It doesn't matter what others think of you. You are God's beloved creation who he has given in Jesus Christ to redeem you and restore you and uplift you. And church, what we do with that is amazing because we take that teaching out into a world that thrives on brokenness, a world that thrives on putting negative labels on people, a world that thrives on negativity, a world that thrives on pushing people down. And we say, you don't get to push me down because I'm a beloved child of God and I have victory in Jesus. Amen. Whew. I'm almost ready to start preaching, guys. So as we come together, church, in a world that is against the gospel, that is against the good news, we stand as children of the light, and we take light to all the darkened hearts, and we share this message. Whenever you see a commercial on TV that says you're not beautiful enough, or you're not happy enough, or you're not prospering enough. You're not making enough money. You don't have a high enough end job. You don't have enough in your 401k, and you failed at life. Everywhere that guy goes, you go out and you get to say to the world, you do not get to define me. I am a beloved child of God, and you are a beloved child of God. Church, I believe if we do that, we live that, we share that, we express that, that this world's going to be different. Let go of the labels. Let go of what used to define you, because nothing else has the authority to define you. God has defined you. I'm going to invite our praise band to come up. As you're coming up, it's my hope and my prayer that you would join me to bow your heads, to close your eyes. If you're watching here with home, I invite you to be in a posture of prayer as well. Lord, we thank you. We thank you, God, that you've given us identity, that you've given us worth, that you've given us value, that we as Christians who profess your name, we have been given the greatest gift that we could ever imagine. And in that gift, in that overflowing grace, that we bask in the glow and that we allow it to define us. We allow it to be the foundation from which we stand. Lord, that everything negative, everything unworthy would be cast away, and that we would only focus on what you have given and what you have said. Lord, that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, that you know us and you have a purpose for us. Even when we think we have no value, you have given us the greatest value. Holy God, pour into our hearts this morning overflow us, that it may come out wherever we go, that we may go out to the world, and that we may speak against the labels, speak against the failure, speak against everywhere that people say we fall short, and that we may take others with us and usher them to the light, because we are children of God. Amen.
Please stand and join us in singing Our God.
Water you turn into wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like to the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God, our God, our God,
There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. Someday morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have grown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars is flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall ever end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Will the circle
And that, my dear ones, is the culmination of that promise. That's how valued you are, is you are going to go home to glory. You're going to go home and be with Jesus. You're going to go home and be the family of God, living in God's house. Now go this day knowing God, the Father, the Son, the blessed Holy Spirit be with you all, helping you to remember, to hold on to cling to who it is that has given you your name. Who it is that has given you identity. Who it is that has given you worth. That you may go and share that to all, to everyone who has ears. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you. Amen. Amen.
Everyone, go forth, and we'll see you next week.
Celebrate the light.
stumble through the darkness. I will call your name by night. God wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy. Lord.